Hey, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Beyond the Summit, Summit 5 China Qualifiers. I'm Luminous, I'm joined by Scansors as we are casting the semifinals of phase number one. The brackets are a little bit confusing, but all we need to know today is that we have Invictus Gaming facing off against Newbie Young, followed by CDEC Youth versus LGD Gaming. Of course, I'm Luminous, and Scansor, you've been patiently waiting on the other end of Skype. How are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty well. A lot of Dota happening recently. Interested especially in this IG team, because they, to get you in the quarterfinal, they had to knock out IG Vitality, which I think if you looked at, for example, the major qualifiers, IG Vitality looked like the stronger IG team. They got further. And IG, which a lot of people think of as kind of Ferrari 430 plus 4, which we can talk about in a minute, I don't think that's entirely true, they're actually maybe a bit on the rise, whereas Newbie Young as well. They knocked out Ehome to get to this round. So both of these teams actually knocked out teams that did substantially better than them right before this in the major qualifiers. So already things being shaken up immediately after the qualifiers finished.
Now, speaking to the Ehome versus the Newbie Young series, I got a chance to watch those games. And yes, the results were Newbie Young edging out Ehome in a 2-1 favor. But none of those games were really like hard-earned in the sense that the team that got ahead just keep getting ahead and just won the game. You know, you never seen a really strong comeback game. So in terms of Newbie Young moving deeper into the tournament, they're going to have to win some games where they have to make big comebacks against some of the stronger teams. But I guess we could talk a little bit more about that later, as well as Invictus Gaming. Whether is this 430 plus 4 or is it not? We have a draft on the way, so Scansor, take us away.
So Enchantress first pick is pretty normal for Chinese Dota, early Batrider as well. The interesting thing about the Batrider is that recently in Chinese Dota, we see Batriders rashing drums. It hasn't really caught on in any other region. Batriders are still going Blink first. Sometimes I've seen Boots of Travel first, but most Chinese bats go for early drums at the moment. So that's something interesting to look out for. And obviously with the Lifestealer picked up alongside the Batrider, that's a, you know, your classic combination. Are those early Lifestealer bombs, and Lifestealer is a trending carry. It's also very, very good against an Enchantress. People didn't see that initially, but it's almost like the Ursa. You use your Rage, you use your Open Wounds, Enchantress's Untouchable suddenly doesn't work, and you can just solo kill her.
Yeah, I would actually think that most melee carries in this patch are fairly good against Enchantress in the mid game, considering that Echo Saber is always an option when it comes to item choices. And yeah, a lot of times you could just kill an Enchantress, especially if you have crits backing that up. But the second pick here for Invictus Gaming, a fairly obvious counter pick to the Batrider, so I don't think we need to talk too much beyond that. I do see some people in the chat asking about LGD versus CDEC. The schedule has been changed. That's going to be coming up after this series, so I do apologize for anybody that was a little bit misled by my Twitter personally, because I definitely tweeted LGD versus CDEC was coming up.
Yeah, I also thought it was the other way around. It wasn't just you. But yeah, the interesting thing about the Vengeful Spirit pick for me, even though, yeah, it's good against the Lifestealer and the Bat, the swap is good against both of them. Enchantress is almost certainly your support. People hardly pick it in the offlane anymore. And that means that your support duo is picked immediately. And I think that this is a support duo that to some extent could be exploited in the lane stage. Enchantress is to be roaming around. And while she's at a lane, that lane's always going to be dominated by her team. When she's not there, when your Venge is the only support on your safe lane, the offlaner can actually get a lot there. Venge is not a support that could like solo zone out a support, an enemy offlaner. So unless you pick a really strong carry to go with the Venge, like a Gyro or a Sven, something that can combo to actually threaten kills, there's going to be a potential for, if it is this Batrider or whoever it is, for the offlaner on Newbie Young to get some space whenever the Enchantress isn't there.
I agree and disagree, sort of. I agree with the point that, yeah, Venge is not the strongest laning harass. That means IG has to pick strong laning cores, right? That's kind of your point.
Yeah.
That's well, awesome. IG probably will remedy it by just picking strong laning cores, and thus their lanes are kind of okay, because it's fairly difficult to punish an enemy team in the lane when they pick strong laning cores, right?
Yeah, obviously. Yeah, I mean, it's just like it puts some pressure on them to actually definitely do it, though. Whereas before, I mean, you know, like they might have wanted to go for a Spectre or something, and like I think if they pick a Spectre, it would be really bad, right? That lane would not work.
Right, exactly. Unless they do some sort of funky Enchantress off lane, and kind of throw us all for a loop for Newbie Young, but
yeah,
we will see. Like you said, Enchantress has not been going to the off lane at all.
Yeah, so one point I just want to make about both teams while the draft's like slowing down a little bit is, firstly, SC, I'm just going to call them that because saying SCCC is like really long. SC is actually the MMR leader in China. I think he's like 8.5k or something.
8.5k?
Yeah, he's really high. It might be 8.3 or 8.4. He's like several hundred higher than just 8k. And very recently it was just the Koreans, the MVP players, who were like 8k in China. And there's a lot of Chinese players have recently gotten there. I think Zhao It's there. I think Aggressive's there. Maybe might be there. But SC's right at the top. The thing I want to say about IG is that Ferrari's four teammates have been playing together for nearly a year. They used to play together in the old team DK. CTY was with them before he joined eHome. And then they became IG Vitality. And then with the recent shuffle, IG Vitality became the normal IG adding Ferrari. So in a way, this IG team should be seen as 4 plus 1, not 1 plus 4, is really my point. Because it's like Ferrari joined an existing lineup of four people that played together for a very long time. So it's not the dynamic that you might guess just because you recognize his name most.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. Although he is in the drafting seat, and I imagine he might be the in-game leader as well. Given that he does probably have, I guess, more competitive experience than all four of them combined.
Is Ferrari drafting? It doesn't look like he's drafting.
Oh, no, he's just in the pink seat, my bad. It's wrong. That's actually drafting. So my apology on that part. But in-game shot calling, and when there's a tough choice, Ferrari's probably got a big voice in that regards.
And he's certainly doing a lot of carrying recently, from what I watched the team. Even though he's playing mid, they're almost always picking a mid, which can actually carry. Like, they've picked him Alchemist a lot, although this game they're the ones banning it.
Right.
So I think his hero is coming last. I mean, the Dragon Knight ban there by Newbie Young was targeting Ferrari. It's one of his preferred heroes. So is the Queen of Pain ban. I like the Weaver pick from IG, by the way. I think Weaver's, I mean, it's obviously great against Lifestealer because you can kite him for days, but Weaver's also a hero that we've seen Alliance using in the past to counter Io, because it's really good at like just slipping behind enemy ranks and bursting down the Io to start a fight, and that's usually the way you want to deal with that hero, right? You don't want to have to attack the person who's being healed by the Io, you want to just get onto the Io as soon as you can.
Or the other way to deal with that is just chrono everybody and just go from there. But something that you mentioned earlier is, again, IG needs to have strong laning cores, and, well, Weaver, one of the harder heroes to kill. Ooh, Storm Spirit, and this is going to be Ferrari most likely playing it.
Yeah.
This is quite interesting.
I don't know if you've been watching Epicenter this morning. I guess the time is different for you, so you might not have been, but Samil just played Storm Spirit right now for EG against Virtus Pro.
I've been seeing nothing but Elder Titans. So I caught the round one games. Yeah. I did not catch the round two ones.
Yeah, so right before this, the game that finished like 10 minutes ago, EG had Storm Spirit for Zamil and they beat Virtus Pro. And I mean, it's maybe not a big deal because Virtus Pro like seems to be the weakest team in the tournaments, and EG had stomped them the first game, and then like next game they picked Storm. But the Storm went pretty well. They also picked it against the Tinker there, which like it's kind of like part of the reason, because teams have started picking Tinker and it's nice to have something that can get onto him. But I just, from watching that game, it didn't feel like, it's funny because Blitz was actually cast again, and he's like the Storm player, and he's been saying that the recent buffs are not enough to Storm. But I personally didn't feel like it felt like really difficult for Samil to make the hero work. It felt like he could actually manage his mana. It felt like he could actually be very effective in fights. Of course, there were combos involved. They had a Darkseer, so they could Iron Shell him, and that made up for extra damage if you can roll, but less maybe, or Remnants, but less, but you got the Iron Shell. And that's not going to be the case here.
I mean, the other thing is that Sumail, you can make an argument for being one of the strongest Storm Spirit players in the world, so he could probably make a hero look easy, whereas normal mortals might have difficulties. Whether 430 is a strong Storm Spirit player, that's left up to be for debates.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. Are you calling 430 a TI winner, a mere mortal? Is that how the mighty have fallen?
No, he's definitely a TI winner, but I don't know if Storm Game is up to snuff, you know? When's the last
I've
time we've
seen him play Storm?
Is it good? Is it legit?
He was good at Storm, but I mean, I only saw him playing Storm during the meta where everyone played Storm.
Right.
So, Samil is standout in the sense that since Storm got nerfed, EG keep every now and then trying to pick him, and, like, the previous patch they picked him, it didn't really work. This patch they're trying again. So far, they've won their first game. Ferrari was great at Storm when Storm was a great hero. I don't like. Will he be great at Storm now that Storm's a bit nerfed? You're right. That's a good question to ask. And he is going to be up against SC, the highest MMR in China in the mid lane. So that's
playing
Vulgar,
nonetheless, you know. That's the pub hero, isn't it? Well, here's the thing, right? If there's a game where Storm actually works, it's probably this one. If you look at the supporting cast of newbie, like, who's actually gonna stun the Storm? There's a lot up to the Invoker. I'm not even counting the bat, in the sense that there's a Venge to protect him as well. So I feel like this is probably one of the better games to play Storm.
Yeah, I think the hardest part of this game is gonna be his lane stage. Yes. Like, I do think Invoker's supposed to win this lane. Outside of the lane stage, I agree with you. The bat's the only thing that could lock him down, and he's got a built-in answer to it.
Yeah, so I imagine the game plan for Invictus Gaming is to have Enchantress basically roaming around the mid lane to give Storm a little bit of assistance, and then it should be a fairly easy game from that point on.
I think that's what they'll want to get down with wrong. It's interesting to me, I'm just looking... When IG, I've been casting them recently, and they pick a lot of Earth Spirits, and I'm pretty sure Boboka is the one who plays it. So I find that interesting. I don't know, like, I mean, you and I, we both play support and we play pubs and mixes or whatever, but I feel like it's interesting that a different player plays the Enchantress and the Earth Spirit, because they're both kind of roaming heroes. They're different kinds of roaming heroes. The one's a jungler, the other isn't. But I sort of expect by default that the person who played the Earth Spirit would play the Enchantress, and it seems like they've switched it around here.
Maybe a little bit of a kind of personal preference as well, depending on the heroes. But right now, Ventral Spirit quite poor, unless she's got some items on the career, and she does 8 tangos coming along the way. Something that we haven't touched on too much, apart from the mid lane, is who do you think's got the better laning stage, and who do you think's got the better draft?
I think IG's draft is pretty fantastic, to be honest, because both the Weaver and the Storm aren't going to be controllable except by the bat, and we've said already, Venge can deal with that. Even Void can help to deal with that. So personally, I'm quite a big fan of IG's draft, but Newbie Young have, like, all of these, like, quote-unquote OP heroes that have these, like, you know, Bat and Io, the historically OP in every patch heroes, and Invoker, the recent OP hero, and Lifestealer, the up-and-coming OP, like, you can't deal with me, carry hero. So they all have ways in which, like, they can exert a kind of pressure on the game that if the enemy team's not prepared, they can't deal with. I just think that IG's draft is quite well prepared to deal with them, so... And as for the lane stage, I would also favor IG depending on the Enchantress, and it's kind of like what you were getting at. If the Enchantress is going to get a lot done, IG's lane stage should go really well, and then I favor their draft overall. But it does depend a lot on the Enchantress getting a lot done.
Oh, 430 is definitely laying down the pressure, taking it to the AK player, and, well, you know, so far he's actually doing quite well in the laning stage. Meanwhile, on the top lane here, it's going to be a Batrider having a lot of trouble. Two lane man actually died here. He's trading right click against Boboka. And Boboka, well, it's going to survive for now. He's going to die eventually, I think. Yeah. But the first blood goes to QD, which for a Weaver, that's actually a pretty big amount of gold. Whether if you want
this
to
is what...
rush Aquila or Midas or what have you.
This is also, by the way, QD, who back when he was playing in DK, his nickname used to be Black Z. I don't know if you recognize that, but he... He's always played Weaver. It's been like one of the heroes he's main for like ever since I've known this guy existed. So he's definitely going to be able to get good value out of a strong start to the game on this hero.
Now, one thing I'm going to be looking forward to is whether he takes the Swarm early build or kind of the more traditional kind of laning with the Gemini attack.
He will get a point. I'm pretty sure he'll definitely get a point,
but in terms of when he ranks it up and how will he play it? Is he going to be more passive in the lane, or is he going to play a little bit more like aggressive, where he teleports in the lane when there's a fight happening, and then just drop a swarm and just go to town? Because something that you mentioned earlier is Weaver does very well against Wisp, as well as Witch Doctor. You drop a swarm on them and they just kind of die.
Yeah, and he's impossible to lock down for a Lifestealer, so he can fight well against that too. It's the matchup. Just I feel like, you look at all the cores in IG, Weaver and Void and Storm, they're all heroes that are slippery, and Newbie Young have a team that's not very good at, like, you know, they don't have a Lion, they don't have that kind of, they've just got the bat. So, I mean, I talk about the Enchantress in the early game, how it's going to be important for IG, but the bat in the mid and late game is going to be like everything for Newbie Young. Finding ways for bat to get pickoffs, despite there being advantage in the enemy team, is going to be really important.
Alright, this Wisp on the mid lane is like trolling me real hard. I was like, how is the creep wave not hitting him? But invisible Wisp, literally not invisible.
Yeah, no animation at all.
Yeah, here we go. Don't think this dive is happening. Here comes the cold snap. Don't think they're going to actually get the kill, but good amount of harass. and Lei dropping a couple of bottles for the Invoker. The thing about Invoker I've really noticed, kind of watching the Chinese qualifiers, or just the qualifiers in general, is that the hero just run out of mana, like, after maybe casting two spells. Which, traditionally, Invoker didn't have that big of a mana problem. I mean, he has some, but now it's just like, you need to keep getting clarity for yourself, non-stop.
Well, looks like he sent in a wand, which should do the trick against the Storm Spirits. But at the same, I mean, so the thing we didn't mention, Invoker's meant to land quite well against Storm, although it seems like Ferrari's doing fine for now. Storm Spirit, the thing that he struggles most with is actually if he gets ganked early on, well, okay, they're going to gank the Invoker at the same time, and that's a Sandsaw plus a Golem that might be enough. Not quite.
The cast is going to come through. There's no Electric Vortex, which is standard, but I would have definitely got the kill wrong. Might be a little bit trouble as well. Cold Snap comes through, Tornado just barely hitting, but enough to get the kill.
So, well, what I was going to say is that, you know, we see this failed IO gank on Ferrari, and one of the things typically that Storm Spirits struggle the most with is if you can successfully gank them before level 6, once they're 6, they're very difficult to gank, but with the IO and a Witch Doctor, you don't really have those are not the supports that want to roam onto the mid lane, and so Ferrari should get to his level 6 without dying, even though it's, you know, it's not great that their rotation into the mid lane failed. I think he'll successfully get to his level 6 this game.
Yeah, although he's looking a little bit rough right now. I imagine a bottle is coming. A teardrop as well. Is that for him? Yeah, it is. Alright, he's definitely not dying now with a teardrop.
Yeah, it's a nice little item. It's funny, like, right at the... Oh, they're gonna kill him.
Okay, alright. Hold that thought. He does have one more bottle charge, but he's gonna die as a result, so...
All right, after we, like...
Yeah, like how we just talking about, he's not gonna die anymore. It turns out that Tornado into Cold Snap is still very, very good.
It's funny because the infused raindrops, like right after the patch came out, no one was buying them. Yeah. And like I noticed, like in the last week, every game, lots of players buying them. So just like maybe took a little bit of delay. And every region, every game I watched, there's like a couple of players buying the raindrops now.
Yeah. Or maybe it's somewhat coincidental that the heroes that do well with raindrop is, you know, being picked, the storms,
yeah,
the dooms and whatnot. But the laning stage going as you would expect, although too late might be a little bit trouble here. QD coming in fast, immediate TP coming in from Lei. No more diving though, mana is out here for QD.
Yeah, I'm still just, you know, waiting for Ferrari to get level... Whenever there's a storm, I just keep watching them until they get level 6 because I expect the enemy team to want to kill them lots of times. But...
I see him actually just only dying once in the lane is okay. It ain't great, but...
Yeah,
this is better.
That's
than...
definitely fine.
Yeah.
It's more like the enemy team should recognize that it's very hard to kill him once he's level 6, so they should be trying to get as much out of that stage as they can. And Witch Doctor is back in the mid lane, so they might go for just one more kill before the Storm level 6 is up.
Sure. So if you have to rate from 1 to 10 how successful this Enchantress has been early game, because that's one of the key things that we talked about her, what's her score?
It's, you know, it's not that high. It's, I would say maybe a 4.
Yeah, that's the number I would have given as well. Oh, he's definitely like, pressuring bottom now and pushing a tower, so maybe that'll raise it to like a 5.
Yeah, he's applying some pressure. He's gotten levels. It's just like he hasn't succeeded in ganks, and in fact, the one gank he succeeded in feeding instead of making the kill. So it's not what you want, but it's not totally appalling. It's not like no game impact. It's definitely having an impact on the game.
Definitely. And of course, the two safe lane cores are trading farm, although Lifestealer having a little bit of trouble for now. A Satyr is just giving it to the Witch Doctor. Tier 1 tower, probably gonna drop, although here comes Newbie's Heroes, throws out a cask, and that might actually put it in deny range. IG is really going for the tower. Tower is gonna be shooting on the XXS Chronosphere, going for it. Alright, they're gonna go on the Witch Doctor as well. The Storm could zip in, he has a double damage. This could lead to double kill here. Jaja does not have his ultimate, although Face Boot. As well as my man has a Blightstone, but Blightstone will not help him in this situation.
You know, it's so interesting to me, Ferrari waited really long to use his ulti, and I feel like this is like a sign of the new Storm. The old Storm, you could jump around
from,
a lot
like, the river,
everyone.
Probably.
Yeah, he waits for his allies to even slow the enemy. Just make sure he's going to actually hit that roll, hit that remnant. Because you don't get, with a storm, you don't get as many chances. It's not forgiving. Yes. You're missing your four lightnings, then you're out of mana now. You miss the kill.
The other thing is, if it was a 3v1 situation, I think he would have just zipped in for it. But since it's a 3v2 situation, I think he wanted to have enough mana to secure the second kill as well. So just think a little bit further ahead. QD just going right on Thule with essentially no backup. But this is also a very good sign of a very strong Weaver player, just like applying a ton of pressure. And he's also got a Blightstone. Alright, last qualifier, I just spent like the whole time complaining that nobody's buying Blightstone. I feel like this is the way to go, man. Like, especially on a hero like Weaver, you are the physical damage dealer, so...
Yeah, same as lifesteal, it's gonna help your feast, right?
Right.
So, I mean, I think when we were discussing the patch, we were both saying it's also nice because the towers are like tankier these days, but have a little armor reduction for them, helps to counteract that.
Well, Storm is level 6, but he's essentially just doing nothing but jungle, which, you know, the hero kind of have to do. Which reminds me of a quite funny game that I watched Waga play. He just straight up jungle Storm Spirit from minute 0, pretty much as an experiment. So he went Iron Tail on and just raindrops and Soul Ring, like just a jungle, right? And it was actually pretty good. So, despite the nerf...
Did he win?
Oh, I never stood around to watch. I mean, it's not. It doesn't matter if he wins or not. It's just
whether. I mean, he got out of the lane stage with like pretty good value.
Right. So, I'm not advocating you try that in your own pub games. I'm just saying that it's okay. It's actually fairly decent.
Well, all right. That's interesting. It's Batrider is going to be on his way to Blink Dagger. I think that's going to be the next important timing in this game. I mean, we did talk about this a few times already. How IG's cores are just really difficult to lock down. You could like get lucky with some casks or cold snap lock early on, but it's gonna be about the bats.
Jungle gank coming in. A big smoke. I think they really wanted to find something like a storm, but they got a Vengeful Spirit, which I don't think IG is too unhappy about. In fact, their now own smoke has popped. And I think they're looking to fight near this tier 1 tower. Storm Spirit, full mana, teleports to the bottom, so this is kind of an interesting move that IG is making.
They've got Chrono online, there's Enchantress level 6 and Weaver, so IG could still make kills up here.
Swarm coming out here, they're gonna go on the Lifestealer. Chrono Sphere not being dropped yet. Chrono now only hits on one, but Lei is gonna die as a result now. SCP being focused. I don't think he's gonna die just yet. He goes invisible, no detection just yet. Wrong, in a lot of trouble. The heal keeping alive just for now. Magic Missile is gonna come in. In fact, they turn it around, Lifestealer is gonna die. And that fight, despite not having the Storm, they did absolutely fine.
Yeah, I mean, it's they have a lot of good heroes to fight into the Chronosphere. You're right, they only got one hero in the Chrono in the end, but the big deal there is really that the Lifestealer doesn't manage to chomp down the Enchantress in the Time of Rage, which is like what we're talking about in the draft. That's typically what you expect to see happen, but Enchantress hasn't kind of all in the Untouchable this game. It's a 2-2-2 build, a little bit extra in the heal and the enchant, and maybe that makes a difference there.
The other thing about the Lifestealer is that there's really no other valid target for him to focus. Great deny here coming out from the aisle. Looks like he'll be able to jump out. Tornado coming in. It will clip on the Void. Can't really follow up against Swarm just at one point, doing so much work, especially against the supports. But yeah, back to the Lifestealer. He actually can't focus on anybody else, right? He just had to go on the Enchantress. And that's something that you touched on. He's gonna have problem being kited the whole game.
Yeah, and it's just him. I was just about to make the same point about the Invoker. I mean, we talk about SC, the super high MMR player. I mean, he's already 3-0, but I feel like if you look at his style in this game already, he wants to run around on this Crosswex Invoker and just constantly go for kills. And I think there's a point at which he's going to struggle to make those kills on the important heroes. Like, he could kill the Venge, he could kill the Enchantress maybe, but the cores are... I suppose once he has an Orchid, that changes everything. Like, and we're talking about Batrider's Blink, but Invoker's Orchid will produce the same kind of option for killing all those cores. And he's actually making pretty good timing on his farm rate this game. He's ahead of Ferrari, certainly.
Yeah, I mean, it just comes down to the timing, right? It depends on whether Ferrari goes for an Orchid of his own, or maybe go a little bit more defensive with the Yule Scepter to protect himself, as well as Lincoln's Sphere timing from QD. So, I mean... it comes down to farm, I guess, for the next couple of minutes, as well as how good they're getting ganks and avoiding ganks. And again, I just want to point out, 12 minutes in, Invoker is fearing himself at Clarity, because this hero is just, for lack of a better word, dumb now. Like, 6 intelligence nerf is pretty big. Oh, nice dodge on Tornado. He's going to try to go invis again, but Chronosphere will reveal him. The question is, can it actually kill him? Looks like they will be able to Storm Zips in from the back. and does secure the kill for the team. In fact, they're going for a little bit more because the Wisp tried to come up with a relocate. That's a double kill for Enchantress. It's
funny thing you mentioned Clarities. Last game when I was watching Samael play Storm, he had raindrops and he was sending himself Clarities as well. It's like some like small in-between thing to make up for Storm using more mana than it used to. And I agree, it definitely applies to Invoker too now in this patch. But if you do manage to manage your mana effectively, the hero's still extremely strong.
Yep. I mean, so far he's essentially played like the AFK Shadow Fiend of the past. You know, just only coming in to secure kills and going right back to farming, right? So, let's see what his first big ticket item is. Do you think it's going to be Orchid Yule's Bloodstone? What's your read on it?
I think he's going to go for Bloodstone. That's what Samael rushed in the last game, and I think it's also like Bloodstone's the reason people want to pick Storm again, because the Bloodstone got a buff in this patch. So it just makes sense to me. I mean, maybe if he sees that Invoker's getting such a good timing on his Orchid, he might feel like he needs to go for the Yules first. But other than that, his plan coming to the game would have probably been to rush the Bloodstone.
Well, let's see if he's going to get there without dying. Newbie though, did you have the blink online? The smoke is, well, mid lane. That's where he is. And they get the kill. So.
Yeah, again, we have to mention it's a Vengeful Spirit though. It's like, you know, every time they make a rotation, if they're only killing the Vengeful Spirit, it's worth a lot less. Here they're going to get a tower as well. So I think, I almost feel like the tower kill is the primary objective here. And
the Vengeful Spirit
happens to make a hero kill. It's
like, the icing on the cake.
Whatever.
Yeah. It's sad when that happens to your Venge. There's a ward kind of scoping out the area. Void is a much harder kill, given the fact that there is no lasso. Never mind, there is a lasso available. I guess I didn't even need to use lasso in that last engagement against Venge.
Yeah, I mean, it was like 4v1 on the tower. Yeah. They had the lifesteal. And, but do you notice this XXS is built on Void? He's gone for Vanguard, which makes him even more slippery. But is he doing the Wagga build, the Vanguard Radiant? So that's, like, not typically something we see in an offlane Void, I feel like.
Well, the standard thing is like the Vlads, right? But Vlads has been nerfed this patch somewhat.
Yeah, it's normally Vlads blink. It's just like when I've seen the Vanguard, I've almost always seen Vanguard into Radiance, but that's always been on. I mean, there's pro games I've seen, it's not just Wagga and Pubs, but it's always a safe lane Void doing that. And,
right, you know, I just don't think he has a farm.
Exactly, he's. So, I mean, maybe it's just a Vanguard, and, you know, happy with that, I'll have a Vanguard.
I mean, Vanguard's fine against this particular lineup, right? Because you just kind of just want to tank up. So,
yep.
Somewhat curious.
It does sound similar to Vlad's in the sense of like it lets you solo jungle as much as you want. I mean, that's not the only reason you buy Vlad's, but it's one of the reasons.
Yeah. Very, very different from Vlad's is that it does not give your team plus damage, which would be very helpful here going on to the Roshan. Looks like we're going to see that standard trade of Roshan for the Dire top 1, T1 tower. And,
do they even get the tower? I feel like with only Invoker and Io, the tower might not even go down yet.
It depends if IG is going to TP for it, which seems like heroes are rotating. I do miss Aegis on Storm though, because that's definitely one of the more broken things in the game. 2 life, so much mana, and just go for kills. Looks like Newbie is going to get a free tower, and ST's going to be able to get the last hit on it. So that should be his Orchid.
It's very well played by Newbie Young. What they did, they only had 2 heroes top, but the other heroes were deliberately not showing on the map.
Right.
And I think that IG were like, we can't TP in there, they could all be waiting, even though it actually was just 2 heroes.
Especially the IO factor also kind of makes that thing a little bit even more complicated.
Yeah. So it's like, we can see that the IO is there, not with someone else, and it's just those two. But Batrider bot lane jumps out and Lifestealer was infested in, that's another
dead
Sphere,
though, that could be good, cannot get it. Storm zips in, really out of mana just from the zip, the Death Ward. Not exactly sure what is hitting. He's gonna go onto the Void, that Vanguard, keeping him alive for just now. Storm Surge, meanwhile, on the back line, dies. Does have the Aegis coming back. He's gonna go for Jiajia. No, goes for the Storm Surge. Go for the Batrider. The Batrider jumps out. That's gonna be a kill that he's missing. They can't even kill the support Witch Doctor. So, at the end of the day, that's a big win for Newbie, taking the Aegis. It might even protect this tier 2, because Storm Surge, the Invoker is 4 mana. He's got a Tornado at the ready. It's gonna hit on Storm. He's gonna have to zip back out, so no mana. Lei thinks about chasing, but that's gonna be it. There's that Orchid finish.
Yeah, the The problem in that fight is that the Lifestealer survived too long. Like, with his Omelette Dukes, he got a few successful Omelette Dukes, and it's not something we talked about because we've been spending so much time talking about IG of heroes that are difficult to kill, but Lifestealer is actually, it's a hero that you have to really make a concerted effort to finish him off, and there was an unfortunate point where Enchantress ran out of mana for Impetus, and I feel like her normal hit, which if it was an Impetus right at the end, would have already killed the Lifestealer. And then he got like an extra Omelette Duke off, and it took them like that extra amount of effort to actually take him down. If they took him down a bit earlier, they maybe can make more kills on mid lane. QD with the...
QD's gonna be... into the EMP, he's fine. The other thing for me is that Ferrari did not really have the best storm play in that fight. The first zip into the fight hit nobody, and the last zip unfortunately did not hit the bat either, so... I mean, that was essentially his biggest chance to really propel himself forward in this game. Because he had Aegis, he had a fresh Bloodstone, and he came out of the fight with no extra charges. So it's like kind of an awkward situation for Storm, because fights don't get any better as the game goes on, because you're not getting any big impact item on the Storm to get those kills. I imagine if they take another fight like that and lose it in the same way, IG's going to get behind. I do believe they're somewhat ahead right now, though.
Yeah, it's a nice adjustment to Storm, though, if you think about it. We talked about it earlier. It's like the current Storm, you need to be more accurate. All of your rolls need to be hitting. And if they are, the hero seems like it's still very powerful, but you really get punished when you whiff a few rolls and don't have mana. Like the previous Storm, the old Storm, you could kind of just zip around as much as you wanted and you'll eventually be hitting people. So it's nice to make it more kind of like skill heavy, I think.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that point. The other thing that I do want to mention about newbie is their late game. Because if you look at the way that newbie is playing, right, they essentially have to play the pickoff game. And even Lifeslayer is kind of just like chilling inside a creep, which is all fine and dandy, until you realize that if they keep playing like this and don't find too many kills, they are going to fall behind in the gold game quite drastically. They are down behind by 2,500 gold right now, but I imagine that's going to change in a bit, because Storm's not going to stop farming. Weaver's definitely not going to stop farming, so how are you going to keep up here? You don't have any Hand of Midas on your Volker, which is... you know, a very standard pickup, but this game he went for the Orchid for the obvious reasons. So, I'm actually quite concerned here for newbie Young.
And also, if we just, like Invoker with the Orchid and Batrider with the Blink and a 4-stop, these are tools specifically for ganking. So it feels like they've built themselves to gank, they need to actually succeed in ganks. If they were to sit back now and try and play the farming game, it's exactly as you said, they've itemized for a different playstyle.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the other point is, like, yes, you could kind of sit back and farm. It's just that the plan B is not very strong plan B, right? Like, there seems to be no plan B. So these ganks just have to work or they just lose. Like, I don't think there's any gray zone in between. Like, it's just black and white. You get ganks or you lose. And I'm not sure whether they can, because IG is expecting those ganks coming. They're moving as a pack of five. We talked about how these cores are just hard to kill. The Vanguard on the Faceless Void makes it even harder. And IG is looking to push.
Yeah, newbie are going for the fights. They do have the Lifestealer in the bats again. So keep your eye out on him.
I think Ven should just stand in front and just like tank it. Oh, the lasso.
Lincoln's tank.
Yeah. I think they're expecting the cast to actually trigger the Lincoln faster. Unfortunately, the travel time of the projectile a little bit slow. In fact, they're going to jump in it right now. 430 misses one jump, still goes in further. He's completely out of mana. That could have been a time where newbie decided to turn around, but they don't.
Well, the thing is that I think the reason he does that is because the bats just whiffed his lasso, and so he feels confident, like, even if I miss, they probably won't turn and jump on me. Like, sure, the Invoker could have maybe still turned and gone on him, but... it demonstrates both points at once, the importance of the bats and the importance of the storm hitting his jumps. But in this case, Ferrari kind of knows, well, with the bats ulti done, I'll just like YOLO it a bit and maybe I get lucky.
So judging from the 21 minute of storm gameplay so far, I could say that 430 is not Sumail. Emphatically.
Oh really? Okay.
He's literally not Sumail.
I agree he's not Sumail, but I think he is 430.
Yes.
You know?
That's also true.
That's my argument. This is like a really interesting player to analyze, because there's like, he's just stayed with the IG forever. And there's some people who would say like his play has deteriorated, he's not the player he used to be. And there's other people who think like his team let him down, and then he's like, he hasn't been in a good team ever since YYF left IG. Like each version of IG has just not been that good. And this is a totally different approach the current IG has. It's the first time that, previously it was like switch one player, switch two players or something. This is the first time that Ferrari's been kind of transplanted into an already existing team. So for me, I want to give it some time and see, like, personally, I believe that he could still be like a god tier mid player if the team like finds itself and finds a place that they like, builds confidence, that kind of stuff.
I also think that, you know, just having a team of relatively new roster, or sorry, not new roster, but like new to the scene. And these guys are not new to the scene, like you pointed out earlier, but they're like
newer,
right? Like compared to, you know, your eHomes and your Vici Gaming and whatnot. I mean, look at Wings, right? Like they're a team that, again, newer to the scene, has the drive and just want to win. That might actually help, you know, Ferrari just having these kind of four youngsters around him to further motivate, inspire, learn from, teach, etc., etc.
Yep, and IG for me, like when I was watching the major qualifiers, they weren't that far off. Like they were in the same group as Tongfu and CDC Youth, and it was like CDC Youth ended up being the stronger of the three teams, but I feel like it was close between those three for the second spot. And there were moments in the qualifiers I thought IG really like looked pretty tight. So I think it's within their reach. I really think that a team like this, what they need is like to build a round of results, get that kind of momentum and confidence, and then we really get to see what they're capable of.
All right. Right now, they're definitely capable of taking map control away from newbie, removing yet another tower. And you can see that newbie is trying to essentially do something similar, you know, split pushing. Here comes a storm teleporting. Batrider, he's going to get jumped on. This one's right on the mark, disabling the blink dagger. And now I think he's completely dead, trying to TP out. And oh no, he's actually going to make it out. 430 had to use the pool a little bit earlier. And because of that, well, the pool is gone to cancel the TP.
I mean, so even though the Batrider lives, it's still like, it makes an interesting point for me because people have gotten used to not playing against Storm. It hasn't been in the meta for a long time. And so you think you can make plays like that. And it's another reason why it's nice to have Storm inside a meta. It makes that kind of situation more interesting. There's a lot of heroes that are like a little bit, precisely like a Batrider, that are easier to like kite around and can farm aggressively. Ember Spirit's another one of those, right? We see a lot of people playing Ember Spirits and they just try and push their limits, go really, really deep when they're pushing. And there aren't a lot of heroes around that punish it as well as a Storm Spirit would. So if this hero does come back into the meta, we'll see a shift in how teams like split push.
Yeah. There will be no successful split push this game. Although Ferrari, it feels like he really can't solo kill like a Storm would in the past. He's not built for solo kill, right? He doesn't have the Gorgon.
He needs to finish his Orchid. He's going there next. And once he has the Orchid, I think he can.
Well, like we predicted, IG slowly kind of leading when it comes to gold, now up to a 5,000 gold lead, 3,000 experience lead. And again, it doesn't get any better for a newbie. So I wonder what's their kind of point of attack. Surely they're not sitting around and just waiting for the end, because IG has map control because they have the Storm Spirit. They could go for Roshan when they want. And they have great team fight with the Void. They have anti-bat with Avenge. How does newbie play this? I'm not sure.
I don't know either. Newbie has like, they have tools, you know. They can try and like surprise you with numbers by relocating across the map, or surprising you with initiation with a ghost walk or a bat.
Oh,
yeah,
nice.
The bot lane, they will get the jump on Avenge, I think.
It's Avenge.
Again, it's just gonna be Avenge.
In fact, they don't even go for Avenge because like four heroes are missing. In fact, top lane, they're TPing back to Fennec Tower 2. Too late is still hanging out here.
It's funny, like, I almost feel like IG specifically decide to send Avenger and no one else, because they're like, you know,
yeah,
we don't know where they are, that tower's been under pressure, it looks suspicious, we saw someone there recently, we'll send our Venge, just see if there's a gank waiting.
Too late, doing some next level split pushing. Here comes a Storm TP again, and imagine that 430 won't use his pull this time. He's jumping, he does use the pull, but Venge is nearby to drop the magic missile, so 430 does get the kill. That's his only second Bloodstone charge. What it feels like maybe 10 minutes after he finished the Bloodstone, but hey, it's been a low kill game, and he's definitely gaining Bloodstone and not losing them.
Yeah, I mean, it's the game is in an awkward spot where newbie young, their draft is all about fighting and ganking, but they know that they can't do that. So like, we see them like they're trying to get ahead by doing next level, like creep cuts against split pushing with their bats, and we've seen twice in a row now that you can't do that against the Storm Spirits.
Yeah, that like, second gank just proved your point, the one that you were making just now. Like games change when there's a storm, like even more so than an Io, for example. And like you said, yep, they gotta kind of keep that in mind.
Aegis. I mean, SC is gone for an Axe, which is cool. Like, it puts him in a position where he could like be more of a carry. But he doesn't, because he didn't go for the Midas, and people don't talk about this enough, I think, but because he didn't go for the Midas, it's not just about farm, it's about he's lower level than he'd like to be. Yeah.
Normally, like, if you want Midas and then you have the Axe, probably like much before this, you're like level 19, 20, almost. Maybe not that high, but well, but
you're
a couple kill.
Significant. You'll be like 17, I think, at this point. So,
and then you get that to a point where you have the Deafening Blast maxed out, and you know you're kind of Gucci for the rest of the game. But yeah, sure, he's got the Axe right now, but you know that's great. It's not enough.
I think IG are waiting for Ferrari to finish Orchid, and then they should hit that timing with still a little bit of time on the edges, like 2 or 3 minutes. And then they're going to go force some aggression.
Lei could be dead. He's going to try to TP out. He will make it, popping the mech for himself as well. I really like QD's build. Got himself the Diffusal Blade to follow up. Obviously expecting the eventual Gold Scepter coming out from the supports. Standing in place.
Diffusal Blade got quite a significant buff in this patch for heroes that don't rely on illusions. It just like burns more mana, it deals more damage. And it's especially nice for a hero like Weaver because you get that double hits in. So, you know, illusion heroes, I guess, were seen as like they cheat with the Diffusal Blade because they just burn away more than the thing's meant to give you. But, oh, Ferrari's been caught, so let's first see.
He's got the Aegis.
He shouldn't die twice. Yeah. They don't have any way to lock him down, do they?
Nice tornado, though. Oh, Storm making a jump. Alright. He does find SC. Really don't have the mana pool to get the solo kill. I say that though, Enchantress is going to come in, and that's going to be enough to get that kill. 15 Bloodstone charges, and counting.
That's actually, you know what, I think it's a good enough value for the Aegis to kill Invoker.
I mean, you dodge a kill too, so that's definitely worth it. Io's going to come in, Tether to the south, and will he make it? Not against the Storm Spirit. Chronosphere is going to hit onto 430, they do get the kill, and Mirror's going to be in trouble as well. 430 is going to get yet another 2 more Bloodstone charge. And the other thing is that the creep wave on the mid lane is going to get pushed in soon, so IG might get this tower as well. I don't want to sound like a broken record, but again, newbie needs to gank or they lose. And I feel like the latter is more likely in this game right now.
Yeah, just the way the drafts matched up, it feels to me like newbie needed to get a lead early on and then like, you know, build on that lead coming out of the lanes, putting pressure, but they never really had that gap in the game where IG's cores needed to be afraid. Like the Weaver and the Storm, and their progression was just so good that, you know, that's kind of what you needed. You needed a point where your bats got blink, but they're still quite underfarmed and they're like struggling to get that farm. But that stage of the game just didn't happen. Got completely skipped because IG had a pretty good laning stage.
Yeah, the actually one thing that I haven't really talked about in the drafting stage, and I definitely should have, is that one thing I don't like about the newbie draft is they really lack burst damage. You have IO Relocate, you have the Batrider. What really makes these hero much better is some sort of quick burst to get kills. I think I personally would have been preferring a Queen of Pain more than the Invoker mid. Just imagine the following scenario where like the Queen blinks in with the Lifestyle inside. Lifestyle comes out and you just Sonic Wave and that's just a kill. Hasn't really came up in the case in this game yet, but there might be a scenario where you jump on the Storm and you just lack enough burst to kill him, or jump on, let's say, the Void, and you can't kill him before he Chronospheres. So.
Yeah, I think it's a fair point. I mean, if anything, I guess the Invoker presents more potential as like an actual carry.
But he's not going to exhort either, so yeah. I'm not sure how much he will be able to carry.
Yeah, that's and they really shouldn't be trying to win the game late game.
Oh, Bubblecut's gonna get Lasso up immediately. He's gonna die, but I don't think they care. Blink Chronosphere is gonna come to Great Chrono. Tornado, though, actually biting them a ton of time. The Silence is gonna go into 430. This Invoker is making it happen. helping his teammate to prevent a couple kills, but I don't think that's going to be enough, as the rest of newbies just kind of too far behind. Stormster making the jump despite having no mana whatsoever, or no health whatsoever. He's still going to play with SC, jumping around, dodging a couple hits, up to 20 Bloodstone charge, and he's definitely going to survive. Goes back and is a happy man. I gotta say, SC played like a champ in the beginning, but it wasn't enough.
He's played like a champ all game. It's almost like this game starts to feel like one of those pubs where you have this super high MMR invoker player, and he's just like, my teammates are letting me die, no one's doing anything. Like, I don't, maybe that's part of why they, like, if you're, I think you have a point that something like the Queen of Pain might have fit better. The Queen of Pain, I believe, was, I think Newbie had banned it themselves. They didn't want IG to get it, so it was before the Storm came out. But I wonder if it plays into, like, picking the invoker, that they're, like, super high MMR players, like, just give me invoker. And I tell you, when that happens in a pub, when you're, like, super high MMR players, like, just let me play invoker, usually the plan is just let them, you know, just, they'll do their thing. And he's certainly done his thing here. He's personally played very well. But that's not, you know, like, in professional Dota 2, it's not just about your mid player, like, having strong individual players. That's never going to win you a game.
Or not, at least not in this case. I could definitely see it like a runaway TA game, like your mid player just, you know, kills mid hero a couple of times, gets Roshan, gets a couple of towers, and you can solo carry games like that, but not in this case. I think the bigger
issue.
The bigger issue in this draft is that IG has, to me, significantly outdrafted Newbie. Like the last pick Storm has just worked so well against the first four heroes of Newbie, and it's tough for them to play.
Yeah, for me it's not just the Storm. It's like, how do you manage to have three cores that are all very difficult for the enemy team to kill? That's just like, because they weren't all the last pick of the draft. You know what I mean? Like, there was lots of time during the draft for Newbie Young to be like, we need a plan to deal with a Weaver. Right. And all they really had is a Batrider, and there was already a Venge. So that's why they decided, okay, well, we'll have an invoker with a fast Orchid. But as soon as Weaver gets to Lincoln's, like, that plan's already, like, kind of shut down. And invoker's Orchid timing, like, he made one or two plays, but since then it's like, you know, I feel like we've gotten past the point where his Orchid can be, like, this oppressive force and really be threatening.
Oh, Mur is going to try to hide invis, but, there's actually no detection.
It's going to work. There's a gem on Void, it's coming now.
The sad thing is you have absolutely no play capability, playmaking capability when you're hiding like that, so that is sad. BKB online here for the Weaver. I don't think he will die this game with Lincoln's BKB at the ready, so I think IG is looking to end this game.
Yeah, I agree.
Oh.
I don't think Weaver will die again this game. And I don't think Storm will die again this game either. I don't think Void will die at all, and he has zero deaths.
Yeah.
So, do you think it's possible for Newbie Young to win the game without making any kills in the cores? Just like 500 kills in Ventral Spirits?
No, I actually don't see a way. Like, I mean, for example, if they have a Magnus or like, you know, a Void of their own, I'll be like, okay, you know, they still have a team fight to play around, but what is their team fight?
The Iroh has a Vanguard, so that's pretty interesting. Maybe Lei's gonna be building an Abyssal Blade, and that'll be their lockdown. looks like he's just going for the Crimson Guard, but Crimson Guard's like, it's gonna make you stay alive long, it's not gonna win you, it's not gonna kill the enemies.
This is the Weaver Please Don't Kill Me build. I mean, another way to look at it is like, maybe Weaver just spends the whole time chasing Iroh around, thus allowing like your Witch Doctor to channel a big ult.
But that's, I mean, you've kind of nailed it. The problem here, right, is that Witch Doctor ults is like their main source of damage output if you look at it. Like, Lifesteal is sure if he can actually stand on you and attack you, but I feel like all the tools that you want in the world for Newbie Young to stay alive long in a fight, they don't automatically win just by staying alive.
Storm making a jump here on Lifesteal. Lifesteal is the one to be dead. Chronosphere hits on two! And the most important one on SC, the swap comes back in. Not exactly sure what the swap was. Oh, he wanted to cancel the relocate, but it wasn't enough. The Chronosphere will prompt the GG regardless. IG making it look easy. And they'll get the Witch Doctor kill on the way out as well.
Well, this is like a huge outdraft. And unless, like, I feel like there were windows in the game where, like, you win the lane stage, you get a good time on your Bat Blink, your Invoke Orchid, and you just totally snowball. That's the only way Nubian could win this game, but that didn't even come close to happening.
Yeah. It's not our draft, but our draft do happen from time to time. I mean, remember that game at the qualifier where there was a team that picked Alchemist and Huskar, and the other team just picked AA, and that was the game? Well, games like that do happen. So hopefully for the next game between IG and Nubian, that we're going to have a little bit more of a fair fight. But the trend does continue for IG. I mean, when they win hard. And they won very hard this game.
Yep. I think they're somewhat the stronger team here, but I expect Nubian to be able to take a game with them. So I wouldn't be that surprised if we go to game three, despite this very one-sided game one.
Yep. Well, that's going to be it for now. We're going to go into game two momentarily. He's Scansor, I'm Luminous. You can find us on Twitter or wherever else. We'll be back shortly. Don't go anywhere, guys.